After my second year of graduate school at the University of Alabama, the one that won the recent football championship, I made the decision that I did not want to continue my studies there. I had not yet finished the master's that I was working on. Suddenly then I was adrift with no place. I'd been living in Tuscaloosa for 2 years. I did the only sensible thing you could do at that age. I moved back home because it was free. I could move there and make a decision about what am I going to do with myself. Came home that summer and my dad found a job for me at General Electric. I think he did that so that I would make certain that was not going to be my final destination, and he was correct in making that assumption. And during that time, I made a decision about what to do. I scoured out different possibilities, didn't know what I was going to do with my life. Finish the master's, do something else, began to consider law school. So many things just sort of swirling in my head with no real sense of certainty, other than the assembly line in Building 4, which was kind of fun for a while, was not the idea of the rest of my life. So I went off to the University of Kentucky. They made an offer for me to come and assist them with their debate program so that I could spend that year making up my mind. Will I finish my master's and go on and get a doctorate, or will I go to law school? As a quick little aside, it never once entered my mind, maybe I'll become a priest, probably because I wasn't going to church. But nevertheless, there I was in that sort of in-between space, not knowing what would happen. Well, in the end, I ended up going to law school, and that was good. I actually stayed there and got that degree, and then started a legal career. I stayed there for almost a decade, but here I am before you today, many years later. But the experience of that summer was sort of fresh in my mind as I thought about the Transfiguration because of that moment that I could pick out of my life when I really had this concept that I did not know what was going to happen next. I had always been able to experience, at least before then, a trajectory. You're in grade school, you're in the third grade, next year you're in the fourth grade. You're in high school, you're a sophomore, next year you'll be a junior, you know, et cetera. That college, much the same way, and I jumped into graduate school almost exactly the same way. There just always seemed to be this next inevitable step so that I didn't spend much time really considering did I want to take that step or not. It never entered my mind that something would happen along the way to make me say, I don't want to do this anymore. I'd really never done that before. And that's what that graduate school experience did to me. As I think back now, we would have to call that for me a moment of being in liminal space. Liminal comes from the Latin root limen, which actually means threshold. Think of it architecturally. If you're in an airport, for example, that's considered liminal space. People are passing through, going from outside to get onto a plane to go someplace else. It's strictly a place of transition, although it's necessary. Churches try to incorporate that in their architecture. The narthex, where you entered, is kind of a liminal space. You pass from the rain outside into the church that we have on the inside. And this being a church that's almost 150 years old, there's very little narthex to be experienced out there since they put as many pews as they could possibly put into this church. You almost lose the sense of liminality when you come in here. But the idea is still there, that there's some form of a threshold. The idea of a threshold is you're coming from one thing and going to another, and you're not going to stay in the threshold, with probably the exception of our narthex, because when this, I'm not going to curse, blankety blank, pandemic comes to an end, you will be in our threshold after Mass, once again having coffee and donuts when things return to the normal way that we like to do things. But that threshold still really is meant to be temporary, to be passed through. It's not a place of permanence. So the two stories that really jump at me from our scriptures this morning also demonstrate this idea of liminality, the being in a space that is transitional space. And so the first story is the story of Abraham and his son Isaac. God puts Abraham to the test, and he says, I want you to take your son, your only begotten son, Isaac, up to the top of the mountain and offer him as a holocaust. There's a request that you don't get very often, isn't it? Now, in Easter Vigil, we tell the full story. We read the entire scripture. It's quite the story. But suffice to say, Abraham is obedient. God's asking him to do this as ghoulish as all of this sounds. But we hear the real climax of that story today. So as Isaac and Abraham are going up the mountain, Isaac's not really clear where they're going to find the sacrifice they're going to do. He's quite unaware that he is the potential sacrifice. And Abraham had to be filled with all kinds of doubt, because who wants to sacrifice their only begotten son, yet God is selling him to do this. When they reach the top and they build the altar for the Holocaust, that is when, and literally, Isaac's laying on top of it, and Abraham's getting ready to do the sword or whatever he's going to do. That's, that voice comes down from heaven: do not lay a hand on that young man. And the Lord then rewards Abraham, not for not laying a hand on that young man, but rewards him for being obedient to God, willing to listen to him. But God would not ask of Abraham to offer his only begotten son. Abraham had no way of knowing that God's intention was that he would later offer his only begotten son. Abraham and Isaac were literally in liminal space between a life they'd once lived to a life they could not imagine, and there they were and found God right in the middle of that, providing direction. Same thing happens with the apostles. It's late in Jesus' ministry, and Jesus takes them up a high mountain. I've been there myself. Those who've gone with me to Israel know that's one of the places we visit, Mount Tabor, right off the Sea of Galilee. And the mountain is where the event of the Transfiguration takes place. Nowadays, to get up there, it's quite the interesting ride in little vans around hairpin turns. The last time we went, it was foggy and rainy, which that should have set everyone on edge. But most of them had not been there before and didn't realize we were literally driving in the fog, in the rain, with our death just hanging right before us as we moved up the road. You get up to the very top of it, and this enormous basilica has been built. I always wonder how in heaven's earth did they get all that stuff up there to build that church. But it's at the top of this very high mountain where Jesus had taken James, Peter, and John and was transfigured before them. You see, the event of the Transfiguration happened without the building, without the road, without all the accoutrement that you would normally go if you go visit the Holy Land. It's just simply the mountain and Jesus, James, and John. There they are at the very top of it, and then we get the story. Jesus is transfigured before them. It's kind of written in an understatement. He was transfigured. This is like a big deal. They're all the way on the top of the mountain, and Jesus turns dazzling white, so white it said that the bleacher can't possibly make those clothes as white as it looks. That's probably an inadequate description. The more adequate description said a little detail Mark tucks in there, that James, Peter, and John were terrified. They had no idea what was taking place. And then Moses and Elijah appear. Now, keep in mind, Moses and Elijah lived thousands of years before James, Peter, and John. How would they know who they were? Were they wearing name tags? Did they announce themselves? I mean, that detail isn't given to us, except that Peter is very clear that Moses and Elijah and Jesus are there. And the only thing he can think to say is, this is good that we're here. Let's build three tents. I wonder where the tent material is going to come from. Maybe the same place that the church came from. I don't know. But his idea somehow was to put control this mysteriously evolving event into something that would make sense to him, that this is a place that we would stay. The minute he says that, Moses and Elijah disappear. I know I'm like you. Where did they go? I mean, did they ascend? What happened? They just disappear. And then suddenly they hear a voice. I guess the dazzling white is now gone. The voice is God in heaven saying, "This is my beloved Son, in whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." The same words that were said when Jesus descended into the waters of the Jordan years before, being baptized by John the Baptist. Once again, the apostles are having what I call a liminal experience. They're experiencing liminal space. They've passed from one place to the next. That's what the mountaintop was. And in that moment, suddenly it was as if all time ceased, which it didn't. Time is still passing. But their awareness of it seemed to be overwhelmed by the dramatic event of God appearing, transfigured before them, Moses and Elijah appearing. It was this stunning spiritual event that knows no real particular bounds of time. We get a little detail as they're climbing down the mountain where Jesus tells them, do not tell this story to others. wondering, is it a secret that they just never supposed to explain this to someone else? Or perhaps the much better explanation, you do not know enough yet to really know what is about to happen. And he tells them, you can't tell anyone this story until the Son of Man suffers, dies, and rises from the dead. And the last line is rather haunting. The apostles talk to themselves as they go down the mountain, and they wonder to each other, what did he mean by rising from the dead? You and I see it from a different perspective. We know what's going to happen. We know that ultimately Jesus and the other apostles are going to go to Jerusalem. And when we celebrate Holy Week in a few weeks, the whole story will be laid out in front of us. We know the story. We've told it over again and again. Those of us going to Germany in 2022 to hear the Passion Play, in fluent German, I might add, none of us speak. And they're wondering if we'll understand the story. I go, this is a story you and I know while it's unfolding in front of us. We really know the story. So remember, we're hearing this gospel today from a perspective of we know what the apostles did not know, what was going to happen next. I'm struck by something Blaise Pascal wrote in the 17th century. He said, somewhere, something incredible is waiting to be known. He was speaking also of this idea of liminal space, this time in between, the immediate present. And in the, when we're standing in the present, we are also standing in something that is the here and the now. In human experience, we experience the idea of past, present, and future. And most of us kind of think that those are like three equal periods. They're really not. It's more like a mountaintop with a point. The past is the mountain going all the way up. The tippy top is the moment that we're experiencing this moment, and then coming down the mountain, which we have not done yet, that's the not yet. Not yet ready to happen. You see, that's how present time happens. It's not equally spaced out, but it seems that way. The only place we have any sense of ourselves, any sense of place, all that stuff we need to orient ourselves is the immediate present. And I'm trying to tell you, that's liminal space. It's like a narthex. It's just simply something that we're passing through. We very are clearly aware, to the extent that we are, of what has already been. So the already is sort of fixed in our mind. But then when we're honest with ourselves, how much of us can really remember all of that already been? How much of that gets confused by what's happened before? And then there is the not yet. And the whole idea of the not yet is that, well, it's not yet, or it's unpredictable. In modern language, we would say this may or may not happen. We just simply do not know what the future holds. But the not yet isn't just simply question mark, we don't know yet. It's simply understanding that the future cannot be experienced. It's just simply the not yet. And so when Jesus takes the apostles up the mountain and is transfigured before them, what they're seeing is the yet of the not yet. But because they're still in liminal space, they can't fully experience it. No wonder they were terrified. No wonder they were confused. No wonder they ask each other, what did he mean by rising from the dead? I had celebrated a funeral yesterday, and I knew that was coming, a big funeral at Ascension, my former parish, and doing that while preparing for the Transfiguration homily suddenly really anchored myself about the whole process of our living and our dying, as that only in the most limited circumstances do we really know when our life is going to come to an end. We know if it's threatened, and we know if we have a serious illness, as this man had, that death is more likely than not, but that we really don't know that. So there's still a not yet that happens with death. Once someone we love dies, that is brought into liminal space. We experience in our moment in time, present immediately, that we've suddenly been separated from someone. And the logical notion that we fall into is that the experience for us is the same as it is for the person that died. How can that possibly be? We don't know what they're experiencing. I try to say in every funeral, we have no idea what happens when we die. Only this person in the casket or the urn in front of me has an idea of it. For him, it is now. For us, it is not yet. And you see, that's the unsettling part about death, is that not yet. What's it going to be? Is it going to be awful? Is it going to be terrible? And our Christian faith has something to say about the not yet. And they say the not yet is the glory that is to come. We're about to profess that in this creed. What I'm trying to tell you then is your life is liminal space. It's like that narthex back there. It is something you are passing through, and you experience it only in the present. You can only be aware of what has already been, and you can only not be aware, but just know that there's something not yet to happen. As Blaise Pascal says, somewhere, somehow, something incredible is waiting to be known. And that is the experience of liminal time. That's what faith is. About the not yet is the object of our journey. The not yet is the fulfillment of everything that we desire. The not yet is the Easter that we are about to celebrate. Eucharist does the very same thing. It happens in liminal time, the way you and I experience it. On the clock, you know, 10:15 on Sunday morning at St. Bridget, from around 11:15, we'll be finished and move on to the next thing that we're going to do. And I think it frequently doesn't enter our mind that when we are in the experience of the sacrament of Eucharist itself, we are still in liminal space, because we can never not be in liminal space. We're living, breathing, functioning human persons. There's always an always, already been, and there is always the not yet. And here we find ourselves at this clock moment of time in the middle of church. You wonder, is he ever going to stop talking? You know, that sort of thing that we're experiencing at the moment. And yet the reality is we're offered a transfiguration experience every time we come to experience in liminal time the sacrament of the Eucharist. You see, all the elements of it are here. Jesus is present. Do you see him? I don't see him. Do you know what he looks like? Would we be able to identify him? He probably doesn't look like any of the pictures that we've drawn of him. How are we going to really know who that is? But you and I recognize him instantly in the bread and the wine when it's lifted up at the consecration. When I genuflect, when you also offer your profession of faith that we make right after that, that acclamation of faith, the mystery of faith. Do we understand it? Of course we don't understand it. But Jesus is very clearly here. We can say that he has entered into liminal time with us. And the encounter in the communion line is the very same thing. You're not receiving a piece of bread. You wouldn't come here to receive a piece of bread. That's not what you're coming for. Or a symbol of something. It's a waste of your time. You and I are coming to see Jesus and receive him ourselves. Take him into our hands. Take him into our body, where he is so intimately present, so intimately in our liminal time, that he is our not yet. You see, not yet for a person of faith doesn't have to be question mark. Instead, not yet is simply a datum of faith. I believe in the life to come. You'll say that at the very end of the creed. I'm like you. I'd like a little idea of what it's going to be like. Everybody wants to know. Like, what are you going to do? Choose an alternative? But nevertheless, everyone wants to know. And yet part of faith is that we don't know that, because it's still the not yet. Eucharist allows us, though, to experience what is waiting. It's no longer just an abstract notion. It's no longer a void. There's no danger of it being nothing, a deep abyss, a darkness. So many people without faith believe that. They think when their life comes to an end, it's nothing, like when you turn the television off. We don't believe that. And so as a result of that, even though the not yet is not known to us, all we have to know is what Blaise Pascal wisely said 300 years ago. Somewhere, something incredible is waiting to be known. This morning, as we celebrate Eucharist, the second Sunday of Lent, as we move towards Easter Sunday, we're still waiting to celebrate Easter. We're still waiting for the end of Lent. But in this moment, in this liminal space, the not yet is here. That's what's waiting to be known.